Good morning, everybody. So my name is Felice Giustino, and I'm from the University of Oxford. I will go directly into the kind of content of the lecture course now, but let me just say that I'm very happy to be here. It's my first time at Cornell, and I hope you had a nice trip for those coming not from Ithaca. And I guess we're going to spend 1 week together. So I hope you're going to enjoy it. And the way we're going to do it is that we're going to try to keep a quite relaxed style. So if you have questions, just ask, and we will have opportunity to discuss. During the afternoon, during the breaks. Okay. So ideally, we should be able to learn something at the end of this week. So maybe let's get started. A little explanation of what we're going to do now. So this is the first lecture. I will just try to give you a flavor of what this thing, density functional theory, can do. So it's really, really a very simple discussion. There is nothing technical about it. So we're going to start something technical in the next lecture, OK? Maybe just two words about myself. I work for the University of Oxford. So I know that there is a town called Oxford in the US, but it's not that one. It's actually it's the one in the UK, which is basically here. This country, which became famous recently for the will to kind of depart from their friends, continental friends. And then, so just to let you know, so this is basically where Oxford is, which is basically 1 hour by train northwest of London. And I'm putting that there just to make sure that you don't confuse it with our competitors, which are Cambridge, and which are here. So the other way around, okay. So that's a quite cute place. I mean, it's the oldest university in the English-speaking world is 800 years old. There are buildings which are absolutely fantastic. But I need to admit that on a normal day, the sky doesn't look very much like that. It's more like looking like this. So probably it's not very different from Ithaca, I guess. Just to explain why I'm here and why I'm kind of interested also in the possibility of having teaching these kind of topics to experimentalists. Well, the reason is that I was not born a theoretician. Actually, I was born an engineer. So I basically studied nuclear engineering when I was in my home country. And then I did 1 year of experiments in CERN, the particle physics lab, when they were building LHC, the Large Hadron Collider. So really, the first time I met DFT is when I was doing my PhD in EPFL in Lausanne. And then after that, I tried to go beyond DFT in the groups of Stephen Louis, Marvin Cohen at UC Berkeley. So that was, again, physics. When I joined Oxford, basically, that was the Department of Materials. And the idea is that what we do as theoreticians, we are supposed to not only do interesting things from the point of view of theory, but also support the experimental activity and trying to help in terms of understanding materials and maybe also trying to design materials. Okay, so this is to give you an idea of how the course is structured. In practice, you've seen this on the website, but the good news is that the schedule is identical every day, so it's not going to be confusing. What we're going to do basically is two theory lectures, okay, like this one, which are going to last. So I wrote down 45 minutes. In practice, some of them will be 40 minutes, some of them will be an hour. I don't know. I mean, I didn't time perfectly everything. Then we'll have a break, a lunch break, and in the afternoon, we'll still have one lecture, so we'll give a lecture. But this time, what I will try to do is to sit somewhere on those tables, basically connect on the supercomputer from here, projecting everything on the screen, and show you how one can start a calculation. Okay, so that's going to be basically a mock-up version of what you will do afterwards. And after that, you will have a couple of hours to try out some of the exercises. Okay, so during those 2 hours, there will be essentially me, Guru, and Beth later, who will be basically walking around the tables and answering questions and discussing with you. And at that point, you can maybe form small groups if you like, just to work together on some problems. Although it's not necessary. If you want to work solo, that's also fine. So it's completely up to you. All right. So let me mention what you have there. Let me describe what that is. So basically, this big thing is two things. So the first half contains the slides that I'm projecting, okay? So you see that only the upper half is printed. That's just to allow you to, you know, mark down some notes on the rest of the page. And then if you go more or less in the middle, you should see basically something which starts like this, okay? So that's basically the second part. That's what we're gonna do after lunch, right? So that starts from how to connect to the supercomputer to how to perform standard calculations, and we will see that in a second. So books, clearly, I mean, it's obvious that there is no way to learn, you know, density functional theory just, you know, within 5 days of lecture course. So if you want to do to become proficient in that, you need to learn on your own something else. So the books that are at the back, so I see some of you got them, is basically something that I think it was published a couple of years ago, and I've written for a very simple reason. In my department, basically, at some point, we decided to try and teach density functional theory to undergraduates in material science. And the point was that what we found is that there were many books around, many specialist books on DFT, but essentially they require a background in you know, advanced theoretical physics. So it's very difficult for undergraduates in materials, which maybe do one course on quantum mechanics, to, you know, to do the leap and trying to understand those books. So this thing is basically a way to bridge between a basic knowledge of quantum mechanics and density functional theory. So in practice, the idea is that all is required is that you're familiar with the notions of you know, single particle Schrödinger equation, you know, going all the way up to the Schrödinger equation for the hydrogen atom, okay? So you must have seen like orbitals like 1s, 2p, and things like that. And you must know that the momentum in quantum mechanics is minus I h bar, the derivatives, things like that. So very, very simple. So that's the starting point of the course. I also would like to point out for those who are going to continue to study this, so suppose you get passionate about that, you want to do something more, there are many books, as I said. The following two books I'm going to describe are just those that I really prefer, but it's my personal taste. There are many others very good outside, out there. So this one is from Richard Martin, who is one of the pioneers of this field, and he's essentially a very comprehensive book. So that means that whenever you have questions about something in DFT, you will find the answer in that book, okay? From the perspective of this course, I mean, it's slightly too advanced, okay? So there is essentially an expectation you're already very familiar with many techniques of advanced, you know, classical mechanics, Lagrangian mechanics, and things like that. So that's why I wouldn't use it to start with. But, you know, as you become more advanced, it would be good to take a look. And then for those who become fundamentalists in DFT, so there is a book which is by Robert Pare, Wei Tao Yang, who are also two pioneers in this field. So this is really about the theoretical foundations, okay? So we will discuss something like the Homberg and Cohn theorem. Basically, there are a couple of important theorems in density functional theory, but we will do that in a very, you know, simplified way. So if you really want to see the maths behind all this operation and why the things we say about DFT actually make sense from the point of view of you know, mathematical formalism, then this is the book that you may want to take a look at, okay? And now, what I'm gonna do now is to just give you a flavor of what is the impact of this kind of techniques, okay? Maybe I'm gonna just move left to right, otherwise, you know, we are disadvantaged people here. Basically, two things. One, what is the kind of impact of DFT in the kind of material science community or in the physics and chemistry? And second, I will try to give you some examples of interesting DFT calculations that cover quite a wide spectrum of applications to just give you an idea of what can be done with that, okay? So we'll not discuss any techniques, just see how cool it is. And then we will proceed with some techniques in the next lecture. So what this is basically a picture from a paper which was published, it's basically a News & Views paper published by Richard Van Noorden and collaborators in Nature two years ago. So he's a reporter for Nature. He's not a kind of a scientist, let's say, in the sense of, you know, running a research group or something like that. Their idea, so actually his idea was to try to basically look at the most influential papers in the history of humankind, basically. So completely take everything together. And clearly they face a big challenge because there are lots of papers out there. So they try to take a very simple approach. They just consider all the papers which are indexed in Web of Science. They wanted to do some counting and trying to see how many papers are cited how many times, something like that. So they came up with this quite cute idea, which is to give a measure of how many papers we have there. Let's imagine that we print out the first page of every paper published, throughout, the history of, our civilization. So if you do that, you find out that the stack made by these papers is about 6 kilometers tall. So it's as tall as the Mount Kilimanjaro. Okay, so that's the idea. So that's why they call it the paper mountain. So for comparison, they put the Eiffel Tower here. So that's so the idea basically is to try to see how many papers there are there, just looking at the first page, and then count how many papers gets more than n citations. So I don't know, probably you cannot see from there, but if you have the PDF slides from the link that Karen should have sent you on Saturday, you can zoom in. And maybe you will see that actually, if you look at this, that's basically 25 million papers, okay, out of the 50 million total. So 25 million papers have zero citations, which is pretty sad, okay? So that's the majority of, half of what we have done is zero citations. Then if you look at the papers which are cited more than 1,000 times, okay, that's the top 1.5 meter, okay? So out of the entire Mount Kilimanjaro, 1.5 meters is cited more than 1,000 times. And if you look for paper cited more than 10,000 times, is 1.5 centimeter, okay? So they put this fly just as a comparison, okay? So basically the point here is that there are very, very few extremely influential papers out there. And then that's basically a way to see, what counts and what not. And this is just citation, so clearly it's a very skewed, biased way of looking at papers and so on. But it just, a very simplified way of looking at things, which gives some ideas. And then what they wanted to do is to examine the first, let's say, top 10, top 20, top 30 papers and see what this is about. So the reason why I'm putting this whole picture here and discussing this is that if you go to the top 10, actually, you will see that most of the discoveries have to do with medicine, genetics, and things like that. So really, really important discoveries which changed the way we live today. But the surprise was that if you look at number 7 and number 8, you have two papers about DFT, okay? So basically, these two papers, actually, they are not the original papers of Homberg and Cohn and Cohn and Sham, so the beginning of DFT. They are more recent. They are essentially from 1988 and 1993. So these are the two papers which kind of define what is called the B3-LIP method, which is a exchange and correlation functional. We will discuss that during the next couple of lectures. It's basically a practical way to approximate, a practical approximation to density functional theory, which allows you to do practical calculations. So this has become so popular that basically this paper in 2014 were cited 50,000 times each. So that gives you the idea of the impact of that. So this is comparing every discipline. So if you restrict that basically to physical science, chemistry, material science, so these are basically the two most influential papers ever written. Okay, so that's why we are, discussing DFT. That's why these things, are important today. We'll try. So clearly, this is a very crude introduction. It is not true that we can do everything we want with DFT, but it just shows you that there is an interest in using this to do something and maybe to discuss about properties which can be measured or materials which can be made, and so on. So this is it's basically more of the same. We are looking basically at the let's say citation rates, how many citations per year the seminal papers in this field receive. Okay, so what you see on the left, so these are the two papers which kickstarted density functional theory. So these are really theory papers, okay, where the concept of density functional was introduced. They are completely theoretical papers. They had nothing to do with materials. They are very, very far from applications whatsoever. Okay, and there's basically clearly there was a very mild kind of increase in citation rate because it was not obvious that that could be useful for material science, for instance. But then, as you can see, things started to shoot up, and what you see on the mid panel and the right panel is essentially Again, the FT, but not really the theoretical foundations, but the practical recipes that people found in order to perform actual calculations, okay? So this is what, these are the papers which define, so the reference are down here. These are the papers which define what people call the local density approximation to density functional theory, okay? As you can see, you know, basically, well, that's already 5 years old, but you know, it keeps going up. And this is what defines one of the possible generalized gradient approximations, okay, to density functional theory. It's yet another technique which we'll describe in the coming days. So what I would like to point out here is that, you see, this was basically invented in 1996. I mean, the citation count is going up exponentially. So in 2010, it was 5,000 papers a year. So clearly now it's much more. So you may wonder why I didn't put like 2015, it's just laziness. I wrote the book basically, I finished the book 2012 and I collected citation counts in 2011. So that's all I got at the time. So we can check maybe later if you are curious. So that's basically to say that at least 5 years ago, there were, you know, about, you know, 5,000 papers every year being published using these techniques. And this is basically up and counting. There is more and more of this coming. So essentially, what you can imagine is that there are many practical recipes which people put forward. So these are, let's say, the some of those which survived. You know, there's a bit of natural selection there. So the best method keeps going forward, okay? It's not that you know, these are the only two methods. There are many, many methods. These are just the most successful. And now what I would like to describe is some examples of what you know, one could do using density functional theory. So this is examples that I picked just because I like them, okay? So there is no particular kind of you know, reason for selecting them. The only criterion is to try to cover various aspects of DFT calculations and show them, you know, what you can achieve with that. So this, these models basically are ball and stick models of particles which are called Bucky diamonds, okay? So essentially these are the yellow is a diamond core and the outer region is a fullerene shell, okay? So one may wonder, what is that? Well, the history is that the story, I mean, behind this is that in early 2000, there was quite some interest in something called detonation diamonds, okay? So these are diamond nanoparticles which are obtained by just, you know, exploding gunpowder, okay? And they are quite interesting because they you know, you don't start, you start from, I don't know, carbon black or something like that, and you obtain some particles which have a core of diamond, so which is very interesting. So it's very strong. They can be used as nanolubricants. They can be used as, you know, field emission, you know, kind of electron guns. So there are many applications, or, I don't know, to you know, to use them as, they can be used as a, basically carriers for drugs in the body because, you know, they don't interact with the human body and things like that. So there are many possible applications. And the point was that it was not clear at the, when they were discovered these things, what is the structure of the particle itself, okay? Because obviously you can do some characterization, so experimental characterization clearly, but there are some things that don't adapt. So this is just an example and is a, essentially a X-ray absorption spectrum of, for instance, graphite or diamond, and then a 4 nanometer particle nanodiamond, so something, maybe imagine something like that. And what people found is that you have a peak which resembles the one of diamond, and there is something else that does not match diamond, does not match graphite, so it's something else which stands there, and clearly that's a bit bothersome because it is basically telling you that you don't know what you have there, okay? So this is very difficult to address just from experiments, and clearly, you know, people try many other characterization techniques, but this didn't go very far. So at this point, what some theoreticians did, and that's basically the group of Julia Galli when she was at Livermore, so basically they took they just constructed a sphere of diamond. Let's say so you take bulk diamond, you carve out a sphere of atoms, okay. And then you use density functional theory to basically evolve each atom at a certain finite temperature and see what happens essentially, okay? So in that case, you will have electron wave functions, you will have atoms moving here and there. And at some point, the structure tends to rearrange, okay? And what they discover is that the structure naturally rearranged in a situation where the particle was not just diamond anymore, but all the dangling bonds were actually folding back together to form a graphitic shell. Okay. So in practice, by doing these simulations, which are essentially ab initio molecular dynamics, they found out that the particle naturally was evolving towards a core shell structure where the core is diamond and the shell is graphite. That's why they are called, Bucky diamonds from the fullerene thing. Clearly, you know, when you do that, that's basically a computer telling you, oh, I believe the structure could be that with diamond and graphite around it, but you have absolutely no proof that that is what is being observed in experiment. So what one has to do at that point is to simulate the experimental spectrum on the particle that you just identified and see what happens. So when they did the calculation of X-ray absorption, so they found for a slightly smaller particle this thing where there is a double peak structure. So that was the graphitic, the diamond core, and this was the graphitic shell. So that was actually a very strong proof that what they were observing is precisely what matches this the spectrum here. So that was the first assignment of the shape of a diamond nanoparticle. Okay, so that's an example of how, when you do a quite sophisticated DFT calculations, you can actually complement experimental activities by providing information which would be very, very difficult to obtain otherwise. So that's basically example number one. So this we're going on the side of more fancy phenomena. That's a second example that's on superconductors, okay? So I'm sure that, there is the name up there, but you probably, all of you recognize this structure. So this is magnesium diborite, okay? So this material was famous, I mean, it's still famous, and basically it attracted a lot of attention in 2001 because it was discovered that it has a superconducting critical temperature of 39 Kelvin, okay? And then it was found out that this is an electron phonon superconductor, like a standard BCS theory. So as of now, this is the superconductors the conventional, so electron phonon superconductor with the highest critical temperature at ambient conditions, okay? Because clearly, I mean, probably you know that a couple of years ago, there's been the discovery of hydrides at very high pressure, which have much higher TC. But at ambient conditions, this is basically the highest TC superconductor. And what is interesting in this story is that if you take a superconductor, basically there are several properties that it shows. One of the properties is that the resistivity goes to zero, just exactly zero below the critical temperature. Another property is that the heat capacity has a jump at the critical temperature. So it would be something like, so it would be going down like that in heat capacity, and then at the critical temperature, you just jump and keep going down, okay? So that's a known property of superconductors. So the trouble with MGB2 was, at this point, that if you look at the experiments, there would be basically these squares, okay? So there is, in fact, a jump. But if you follow the BCS theory, there would be this dashed line. That should go down like that. Essentially, it's an exponential curve, okay? But in the experiment, the situation was slightly different. This was going down, but then it was exhibiting a knee here, so some kind of bump. You can see that. So if you use a standard BCS theory, that doesn't work. So what people did is basically use density functional theory, okay, as a starting point to perform something more advanced, some calculations which are more advanced, which are based on a, let's say, refinement of the BCS theory, which is called the Migdal-Eliasberg theory, okay? So that's pretty much the best we have today. So these calculations were done by Yung Jun Choi and collaborators when he was in Berkeley. And essentially, by doing this calculation, he got the red line. So you can see basically that he can find this bump using this theory. And at that point, so when you have agreement with the experiment, you can ask, so what is the origin of this bump? And the answer actually in this case is quite simple. Now there is quite a consensus that in magnesium diboride there are two distinct superconducting gaps, not only one. So this bump comes from the second superconducting gap in practice, okay? So that means something which would be very, very difficult to identify otherwise, you can get naturally out of a advanced calculation based on density functional theory, okay? And that's an example on superconductors. So, let me stress that these things are not standard. So the calculation I showed you before and this calculation are not something that you can do just by pushing a couple of buttons on a standard software package. This is basically, I'm showing you the best that can be done these days. So they require a lot of effort. But I mean, it's good to, I guess, give you an idea of what has been achieved. So this is another example, which I like because it's a situation. Basically, it's about a situation where you don't have already, a very clear experiment, and then you are asking, oh, what theory can tell us about that? So this is a case where the experiment is very difficult, okay? So the question that people were trying to ask in this case is the following. What is the temperature in the center of the Earth, okay? So the planet has an iron core, which is solid, okay? And then there is that's called the inner core. Then there is the outer core, basically. So there is something like that, inner core, which is a solid, and then there is the outer core, which is a liquid. So the idea was maybe if you could tell the melting temperature of iron, which is the main material of the core, so that should be the temperature precisely at the interface between the inner core and the outer core, because the two phases, liquid and solid, are in equilibrium, okay? So the catch is that you need to determine the melting temperature of iron at the pressure existing at this point. So the good news is that pressure is easy to determine, so it can be determined because you can do seismic, basically you can look at the seismic data, and you can model the planet like basically a giant continuum solid with a certain elastic constants which depend on depth, okay? So in practice, from these measurements, it is known that the pressure here is 350 gigapascal, okay? Now, one can try to look at the melting temperature of iron at these pressures using diamond amyl cells, so very, very high pressure experiments, but it's really pushing the limit of these experiments because you are approaching basically the limit of plastic deformations of diamond in the anvil, so you don't know what you're measuring. And in fact, if you take different labs around the world, the estimate melting temperature here was fluctuating about 2,000 Kelvin, okay? So, I mean, it's big temperatures in practice, so we're talking about something a few thousand Kelvin, but still, basically, the error was the order of half of the actual value. So the error bar was very large. So at this point, there was a group from a University College London, so this is Daria Alfay and collaborators, who decided to try to study the melting curve of iron directly from first principles using density functional theory, okay? So the way to do that is not easy, but I mean, conceptually simple. You want to find the point where the Gibbs energy of the liquid and the solid are equal, okay? So one determines basically the Gibbs energy of the solid as a function of pressure and temperature. So the same story for the liquid as a function of pressure and temperature. So those two things define two surfaces in a PT plane. The intersection gives basically the melting curve, okay? So that's where the liquid and the solid are in equilibrium. So this was done by performing calculations of phonon dispersions, okay? Which we're gonna do on Thursday probably. And for the solid, and for the liquid, they also did, once again, ab initio molecular dynamics, okay? Because it's a completely disordered object where things are moving around. So the good news is that at this point, they managed to find some points. So basically, this is the theoretical line. These points are experimental estimates, and what they managed to do is to find the melting point at 350 gigapascal, and they basically determined that the temperature there should be 6,700 Kelvin, okay? So as of now, this is essentially the best estimate we have for the temperature at the center of the Earth, okay? And this came directly from a calculation. So this is basically one example where the experiment is too difficult to give a value which is very reliable. And at that point, the calculation can try to help. Now, I have only two other examples I would like to show you. Hold on for a second. So this is a situation which is slightly different from what I showed you before. It's more in material science. All the examples I gave you so far are either basically considering a very small system. So in the case of iron, you have one atom per unit cell in the solid. So it's quite an easy calculation in principle. In the case of MgB2, you have three atoms in the unit cell. So that's three atom calculation. If you're doing material science, often you have to face problems where maybe you want to study brittle fracture, mechanical properties of materials, where really things happen on very, very different length scales. So this is an example of essentially a snapshot of a simulation of a crack propagation in silicon, okay? So why this problem is difficult? Well, the problem is difficult because in practice, this is something which happens on microns or length scales, okay? So you cannot run DFT calculations on microns. You can do maybe 100 atoms, maybe 1,000 atoms, maybe 10,000 if you really stretch it, but you know, it gets really, really difficult, okay? And you cannot do basically time evolution on 10,000 atoms very, very easily. So at some point, for these things, people use a classical force field method. So basically, each atom interacts with another atom using just an expression for the force, which is analytical. Okay, so very, very simple. So they are very fast methods. So that's what is done usually. The problem is that that's okay when you are very far away from the crack tip. Okay, so you actually, when you are very far away, you cannot even use a continuum elasticity theory. So very, very simple kind of equations, like differential equation for elasticity. But near the crack tip, what is happening is that basically there are atomic bonds which are snapping and reforming at, you know, all the time. Okay. So there are electrons jumping here and there, forming bonds and destroying bonds. So that cannot be described using classical mechanics. You really need a framework where electronic wave functions are present. So there is a dilemma here, which is the fact that you want electronic wave functions, but that's too much, basically. You cannot study that fully quantum mechanically. So what people developed in this area, and that's something which has been going on for several decades, is something called QMMM, which means quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics. That's basically just a way to say we want to do quantum mechanics just in a very small region, and then classical mechanics in another region, and trying to couple those two so that we don't waste time and resources to do quantum mechanics where we don't need it. So in this picture, basically, all the atoms in red are described using quantum mechanics, okay? And all the atoms in blue are described using classical mechanics. Okay, and then at the boundary, essentially there are forces which connect, which stitch together these two regions. All right, so this is in general, you know, an example of QMMM. And in this work, basically, this is a group from led by Sandro De Vita in King's College London, where basically what they showed is that if you try to do standard QMMM, that's not accurate enough to study crack propagation in silicon. So one of the problems is that if you start to open a crack in silicon, with standard methods, it keeps propagating along the 001 direction, so like this. But in experiments, it is seen that the crack typically defects and goes along the 1-1 direction, okay? So in order to explain that, they wanted to do something more accurate than what was available at the time. So they had this idea. So let's describe everything classically, okay? But let's basically tell this region that every 10 time steps in our evolution, we do a quantum mechanical calculations and we refine the forces in this area using quantum mechanics. So everything is classical, but essentially you are teaching the system to behave as a quantum system in the region where you're interested in that. And with these techniques, they managed to actually to reproduce this deviation of the crack propagation. So that's actually it was quite an advance in this field, and there are many people working in this area now. So that's basically it's what people call multi-scale modeling on materials. So you can imagine the complications are enormous because you not only have to do good quantum mechanics, you also have to do classical mechanics, and you need to put them together. So there is a lot of people working in this field, and there are still many open problems. Okay. And then final example, we're going to conclude in a couple of minutes. So this is basically an example, and in the book, basically, I put something from the group of Norskov, who is now in Stanford, I think, about design materials for catalysis. But then on the slides, I changed it because recently we've been doing some of the same. So I thought, why don't I give you something that we've been doing ourselves? So basically, this is a situation where we don't want to use calculations to explain an experiment, okay? We want to use calculations before an experiment is performed. So in this particular case, the question was very simple. So we are working on things like halide perovskites for solar cells. And one of the questions was, the highest performance solar cells have lead inside, okay? So that is toxic. And one of the questions in this area is it possible to replace lead by something non-toxic? So what you can do is to do synthesis of various materials. You can try to make new materials. You can try to do high throughput synthesis with robots. So many people do these things these days. Or you can ask theoreticians, why don't you try many compounds? And then you tell me which one is the best, okay? So that's basically what we did here. So these are very simple density functional theory calculations of band structures, okay? So the same that we will do on Friday, but for a certain number of compounds where we basically consider perovskites, where we have 3+ and 1+ elements here, halides here, and some alkalis here, okay? So we just did a lot of calculations, looking at the band structure in exactly the same way you're gonna do on Friday, okay? And the idea was, if we identify one compound with a band gap in the visible, so it would absorb visible light, and with good effective masses, so it would be a good electron transporter, at that point, we pick up the phone, we call experimentalists next door, say, can you make it? So the good, clearly, I'm showing you this because there is an happy ending in the story. And in practice, one of the compounds, actually two of the compounds that we predicted was made by our collaborators. That's the group of Henry Snaity in Oxford. And these things are now going to the direction of basically devices. So we are trying to see really whether the optoelectronic properties work. So there is really a case where the DFT calculation starts from a computer and ends up on a device, which is basically what we really would like to do. And I take that is also the mission of this the paradigm program. So that I think we are on the same page there. So last two slides before you start yawning. So then we're gonna have, I guess, a coffee break. So that's just to give you an idea of how far this has gone in for DFT. It's clearly just history. So the first paper on DFT, so it's really 1964. So we're talking about something which is, 52 years old. So it's really old, okay? Now it seems that it's something, it's something very, fancy and innovative, and it is now. So the techniques that exist now are very, very advanced, but really the concept itself, goes back a long way, okay? And actually, if you look at books about density functional theory, they will tell you that in this paper, really, they put together concepts which were already designed, let's say, thought at the times of Enrico Fermi, essentially. So when Fermi did the Thomas Fermi model of the atom. So it's really something which, let's say, is connected to the very origin of quantum mechanics. Just a couple of other dates. So this was without spin. At this point, it was extended to spin polarization, so local spin density functional theory. These two were really methodological developments, so pure theory, okay? At that point, people were not using computers to do calculations. So this is the point where a couple of researchers, Seppelin and Alder, they're basically trying to calculate properties of something called the homogeneous electron gas, which then proved absolutely critical to perform DFT calculation on real materials. Then there were many other developments, like the extension of DFT to excited states. Then the development of what I mentioned before, that is basically the Carparinello method. That's ab initio molecular dynamics. You will learn during this course that the density functional calculations of band gaps are pretty bad. So they usually in quite, they're not in good agreement with the experiment. Well, that is well understood now. And there are techniques which are basically called quasi-particle techniques, which we'll discuss on Friday, which also are now, let's say, the golden standard for these calculations, but also they were developed in the mid-80s. What we're gonna do on Thursday for phonons is something which basically was invented in 1987. It's called density functional perturbation theory. That is basically for calculating properties of materials in linear response, like under electric fields, or elastic properties, or phonon dispersion relations. So that's all 1987. And I put this on here because this is the same date of the two papers that I showed you when we were doing the tower of papers, this stack of papers. These are the two papers which are the most cited so far. Then I'm sure that some of you, if you are working on magnetic materials, you heard of the fact that theorists use something called DFT plus U. Okay, so U would be the Hubbard correction. Well, that was invented in 1901, basically. The generalized gravity approximation in the version that I showed you in this plot, 5,000 citations a year, that was invented, so the PBE approximation, that was 1996. Now I could give you, bits for every year, but as you can guess, what has happened basically is that the community doing these things has become enormous, okay? So there are many new advances, and they are going very fast. So I think there is no point at this stage to continue with this historical survey, because also we don't know which methods which have been developed these days will survive in 10 years' time, okay? So these are really the things that are still important today. There are many other kind of methods which were proposed, but didn't basically pan out, didn't work out as well as the others, okay? And this is basically my last slide for today. I just want to say that for this lecture, I want to try to ask some questions that people typically answer some questions people ask me sometimes. So the first thing is why the DFT has become so popular. I mean, I guess the first answer, which is the most important, is that DFT is not one thing, okay? It's a set of things, and it's really the way of doing, you know, computational material science with atoms and electrons, you know, using quantum mechanics. So it really is an umbrella for many, many things today. So that's why it's so big, in a sense. It's not a single theory anymore. But I would say that one of the most important things is that if you you know, look at papers from the 80s, suppose people were doing, I don't know, you know, 3-5 semiconductors or quantum dots or things like that, and they were working with type binding methods, okay? So if you do, you know, a cadmium selenide quantum dot using type binding, you need to write a type binding code for that. Then the experimentalist comes to you and tells you, oh, now I don't care about the cadmium selenide, I want cadmium sulfide, cadmium selenide, core shell, you know, quantum dots. And they put also a bit, I don't know, of nitrides. And at that point, what you have to do is to trash your code and write a new code, okay? So it's basically, it's a very, very painful operation where you have to redesign a new software for each material you're looking at. So in DFT, the way it has evolved is that you have one software, and essentially, you know, if you want to change material, you just have to change, you know, which atoms, which, you know, atomic number you're putting in. And that's why it is, so you develop an infrastructure, which then you can use in many ways, okay? So that's, I guess, one of the main things. There is another appeal of you know, DFT compared to other methods that are very used in quantum chemistry or things like you know, Monte Carlo techniques. So there are many methods which are much more refined, okay, and also much more expensive. So why DFT basically keeps going? My personal view is that it is simple, okay? In practice, we end up solving Schrödinger equations like for the hydrogen atom. So it's not very far from what we learned when we were undergrads. So in a sense, there is an appeal of, you know, sticking to something we are comfortable with and trying to, so then you, clearly you can complicate the process, but the root is very, very intuitive. So that's why people may like it. And clearly, I mean, we wouldn't be here today if, you know, you do a DFT calculation, you get absolutely horrendous results. I mean, so if it doesn't match experiment at all, that's completely useless. So one of the reasons why this has boomed and is very used nowadays is that when people started calculating, I don't know, lattice constants in solids or vibrational frequencies, you know, they were getting numbers within 1, 2, 3, 5% from experiment. So that was quite spectacular. And, you know, the point is that one is obtaining numbers, you know, this kind of accuracy without any parameters. So just starting from the fundamental constants of, you know, quantum mechanics, like H-bar, electron mass, you know, the KBT, KB, things like that. So there is absolutely no parameters. And from that, you can get numbers which are within a few percent from experiment. So that's actually why it's appealing, because actually sometimes now you can start using these things as a complement. So if both experiment and theory say the same, then maybe there is a chance that you know, talking about the same thing and you are going the right direction. So I think it has become very important now. I mean, now means, let's say, in the past 10 years, I would say, is that maybe until, you know, even when I was a student, as a PhD student, people were developing their own software. So each group had a software, and in practice, you know, you go doing your PhD or your postdoc in the best group with the best software. You know, that's basically your, it becomes your alma mater somewhat, and you stick to that for the rest of your life. So like when you have here an MBE machine, you know, people come to work on this MBE machine. So now things have changed because, you know, it's very easy to share software via internet, via, you know, very many possibilities for collaborating online. So essentially, now the thing has evolved in a way that, you know, people try to develop software infrastructure in a collaborative way. And it's very easy to find out that software you're using are being developed by hundreds of people scattered across the globe, okay? So you don't need to have a major investment to start with. You can just chip in, contribute a little bit, and keep using that, okay? And that's also related to the kind of open software revolution, where people basically find that sharing things actually in the long run is more convenient than actually keeping it for yourself. Because then what happens is that you make something available, and then clearly you lose something because, you know, you spend a lot of time developing that, but then you will find out that people come back to you asking for, you know, collaborations, for, you know, doing something together. So it's very good in the end. And then the other thing I would like to say is that when we talk about DFT, it is not just the DFT technique itself, which is important. So in many cases, we will discuss that during this week, it fails. It gives very bad answers. So band gaps are completely ridiculous. Magnetic systems are very difficult. Van der Waals interactions are not treated correctly. So there are many problems. But the point is that when people try to address these issues, they still start from density functional theory. So what you do is to do a DFT calculation first, and then you try to refine on top of that. So even if that is bad per se, it is basically a platform upon which you build something which is better or more accurate. So that's a bit the idea. And I guess that's the final slide for this thing.